I know Sonny from a very long time. I can't even remember when, and ever since I know him, he's always been an activist, a lover of my people, and he's always saying, I'm going to find a moment, one time in my life to make a difference. And I just love him because of that passion. He's never changed. In fact, it's getting worse now. I can hardly talk to him without saying one word. It says Nigeria and potential. And that's why he's driving us to this point. He's the one who called us here because of his life, his history, his love for our people, his experience. Because of all this, he went to school in Holland and qualified. And really, the connection I see him making and the people I see here, I mean, you guys are great to just come and stand and to hear what is happening in Nigeria and the potential in Delta State. I am from Delta State as well. And I just love my state as well. But as you know, the greatness of Nigeria, I believe Nigeria cannot solve this problem just like that. I believe that diaspora would have to step in to assist the people in Nigeria. And I think the potential there, once is fully harnessed, can not only bless Nigeria, it can bless the world because of the vast, it's a virgin place at the moment. There's actually virgin land, but we are proud that we are being given the responsibility to run that state and Nigeria as a whole. So Sonny asked me to do this, to just welcome you guys. And we still have coffee and tea. And of course, networking has been going on. Let's see. We want to open this by calling for a welcome address by Mr. Derek Boss. Can we give a round of applause to the gentleman? Welcome, sir.
Love ons woordje te doen. Het doet me deugd dat jullie hier vandaag zijn. De reden dat Sunny aan mij vroeg, ja, zou jij het willen openen, is dat als Sunny gaat reizen naar Nigeria, dat hij altijd probeert een white guy mee te nemen. En ik heb een aantal malen met Sunny mogen ervaren. De eerste keer keek ik volledig door een Nederlandse bril. En de tweede keer dacht ik, dat moet ik niet meer doen. Maar al die beide reizen waren enorme mooie ervaringen. En met een aantal mensen die vandaag ook zijn, staan we eigenlijk al een aantal jaren om Sunny heen. Om hem te helpen daar waar wij kunnen. En ik ben blij dat ik... Ik moet even zijn telefoon uitzetten. Ik ga nog iemand aan jullie voorstellen die praat over zijn ervaringen. Ernst, kom even naar voren. Ernst, ook een van de, en ik denk de langste trouwe metgezel van Sunny op al die reizen. Ernst, dokter Ernst moet ik zeggen, hij zichzelf al introduceren. En ik ben blij dat ik deze aan jou mag geven. Succes.
Dankjewel, Diederik. Ja, mijn naam is Ernst Franzek. Ik ben geboren in Duitsland, 5 februari 1953. Dus volgend zondag ben ik 70. Gaan we vieren in München. Ik leerde Sunny kennen al in een tijd waar ja, het einde van mijn Berufsleben nahte. Maar, oh, I should speak English. Okay. Okay. Oh, I will speak English. So, at the end of my professional life, I was looking back and I was looking forward, and I thought that I have to do something more special, what has something to do to improve the life of people. And I met someone who introduced me to Sunny. This was in December, this was 2017. And I met him at a Novotel. And I explained Sunny my research. My research at that moment was that prenatal malnutrition causes somatic and mental diseases later in life. For example, also diabetes and some severe somatic diseases, but also mental illnesses and, for example, antisocial personality disorders. If the baby is not fed well in the womb, it is predisposed during the whole life to show antisocial personality traits. This is actually, I take a lot of studies, review the literature. This is necessary because to find food and to fight other people, you have to show some antisocial personality traits. When I remember my mom after the Second World War, my mom was so peaceful, but we stole potatoes from the neighbor. So this is just to survive. So, and Sunny told me that he has the ambition to become the governor of Delta State. So, yeah, I'm not a politician, And first of all, when I'm a psychiatrist, and I thought, oh, is this real? Or is that, are these ideas of of Grande? Yeah. So is this man healthy? Can he do this? So I followed him since 6 years, and I can assure everybody here that the ambition of Sunny is based on reality. He has a good intelligence. He is enthusiastic, and he knows what he's doing, and as Diederik say, when you go to Africa, to Nigeria, this is quite different to Europe and to Netherlands. The first time when you are there, you get a shock, yeah, because you can't understand what happened there. So, what I did with Sunny in 2020, we founded an NGO, Legionnaire for Mankind's Health. It's a non-government organization, and this organization has the task to help to develop healthcare system in Nigeria. And first, in Delta State, you should know that, for example, children, one of five children dies before the age of five. These are 20%. When we look to Netherlands, this is 0.0, so it's more than 2,000 times higher. And to be pregnant in Nigeria, and so this is just an example what happens there. The mean life expectancy in Delta State is lower than 55 years because of the degradation of the environment caused also someone is is here in Netherlands. So, to improve this country, there has to be a lot to do. It's not enough to go to the grassroots and only try to motivate the people to do something. No, it is necessary to have someone on the top who really wants to do something for the people, who will serve the people to improve the people's life. And I'm now five times with Sunny in Nigeria. Last time is a week ago. We have been there for 10 days, and it was very impressive when I saw how his, the population appreciate him. We have been by the King of Bori and in some youth organizations, and I was really impressed. I can only say Sunny is an honest and Sunny is an intelligent, and we can trust him. This is what I can say from my psychiatric standpoint. I don't have a political meaning because I never was a politician. Yeah. Maybe in the future, the rest of my life, I don't know how long I have, but I will invest something. Maybe I become a politician, I don't know. Yeah. I never know. Okay, this is me, and I welcome you here. And I was with this young man, with Bart. I was impressed about this young man. Yeah, yeah. He's 19 and I'm 70. We have a big difference, but we are the same. Yeah, how are the same? how to say.
You're both young in mind. Huh?
Yeah. This is very important, to keep your mind young. And to do this, you also have to keep your body young. Yeah. And so,
yes, I appreciate you, Mama. Added so much titles to my friend. He deserves it. He deserves it because I've seen his labor from when he arrived in this nation and all he went through, the struggles, and it only tells of his credentials. Whenever he goes to a place, they want to honor him with a title. And that shows how much he means to a lot of us in Nigeria. Comrade, in my country, a chief is so important. A chief is a high honor. When you call somebody a chief, that means you really see him as a community person. And it doesn't come easily. So when I saw he was crowned a chief, I was so glad. Because that means his voice is more powerful among our people. And he's a doctor, of course. And I want to say this. Sometimes what we need in our nations is exposure. And I was going to say, my friend, now I met you newly, that the internet has given Africans an exposure, but that's not enough. I think if we have a personality that have gone far and come back with not just a passion to have his name known by making himself big, but he wants to help the community, I think it's a big plus for the nation or for our people. So I think this personality of Sonny has not only left Africa, but have come to Europe to improve his ideas and his perspective of life and how life should be done, plus the richness of our culture. So he has a powerful combination of a personality that can really bring a change if given the opportunity. One day he sat in my business, I sat down, we were talking, and when he was looking at me in my eyes and talking, I just felt the passion, and he made me love my country. And that's a shame to say that. At one point, we were very, very disconnected. We were very, you know, we were tired of the presidents, we were tired of the leaders. And we all just got like, you know what, leave Nigeria. We got into boats and walked through deserts and walked through rivers just to come to what we call the greener pasture. But yeah, this country has been blessed to us. We've been enriched, we've developed our minds, make new friends, make connections, and we now see something different. So if him, as my friend, goes back to Nigeria with this exposure, I believe a change will come. A change will come. And that's what we need. We need diasporas to go back and bring this change. The first deliverance we need as people is the mental strength. The mental mind have to be charged up and renewed. And that's what he's bringing as well. Not just the fact that he's just want to develop, but he has an idea, he has a concept. You know, he has a dream, and his dream can really change our lives. So I don't want to talk too much. I just love the man. Let's see, we have another speaker. And to share with us his Nigerian experience, Mr. Bart Decker. Let's give him a hand clap.
Well, small speaking numbers. If you do not understand me clear, please just wave or something, because my English is not the best. So it's a big honor to be here, so thank you, Excellency. It's really amazing. You know, today we are gathered with a group of people we don't meet in our day-to-day life on a regular basis. Today we are together with some people with actual ideas and a vision, and that is nice to be here, because I see people from different backgrounds, I see people in different jobs, and that is nice, because you people, you are not the people who stop thinking at the border of your country, not even the border of your continent. No, you have the creative minds with an actual vision to look further, and that is really pleasant, those people to be around. So I'll shortly introduce myself, and after that I will tell you something about my trip to Nigeria. My name is Bart Decker, I am 90 years old, And I've grown up around a company, it's very international, it's in heavy equipment, and our main focus is Africa. So while growing up, I've always had the honor to meet people from over the whole world. And while talking to all those people, I created a sense of awareness about the world. And unfortunately, I cannot become an African politician due to my passport, but I tried it as well in Holland. I've been the youngest board member of the youth organization for freedom and democracy in Holland, and it has been a big honor for me. Currently, I've understood that politics go hand in hand with economics. So currently, I'm a student at Wageningen University, and I'm specialized in developing economics, and especially Africa. Sunny knows it, and I was invited by His Excellency to Nigeria. And I'll share with you something about my trip by telling you three things. The people of Nigeria, the economic state of Nigeria, and what I believe are the changes Sunny can bring to this amazing place. Starting by the people, from arriving at this moment, for me it was amazing. The people in Nigeria are very friendly, very warm, and amazingly intelligent. People are very eager to learn and very open to other cultures. For me, that was really like going home. But there is a problem. Last week I was reading the NRC newspaper. 32% of the people in Nigeria are without work. And for people that are so motivated in life, that's quite a bad thing. You see, people are amazing there, but there is a problem with our economy. Leaders, corrupt leaders, are destroying the country. Although there are so much opportunities in Nigeria, we have the old opportunities, we have oil, gas, minerals, very interesting. We also have amazing rivers where we can put energy from. We have the amazing sun, where nowadays we also can get our energy from. So these opportunities that are here needs good leadership that is able to take those opportunities and use it for the people, so it can bring actual change. And I know this man has done it already for quite a long time. You know, in an economy where 1/3 of the population is without a job, every dollar, every euro in the economy can actually make a difference. And this man, he already has done business with Nigeria, and he knows that every euro can make the difference. So I know also some businessmen are here today, and you can be sure that all the business you're doing with Nigeria at this moment is making quite a big difference, because that can mean that somebody has a job and can support his family. And while talking about this man, Sunny Ofehe, I must say I've been very, very impressed. He has seen all the life in Nigeria, the lower life, the higher life, and he came to Holland, and now he's going back to Nigeria. And people really appreciate it. I have seen it. He can connect with all the people from whole Nigeria. We met in Abuja with the people, the Muslim people from the northern states. They even knew Sunny from Facebook. So, and they were immediate friends, and that's an amazing thing to see. And the good thing about it is that the good thing about that is, in the way he can connect with all those people, I believe we have someone who can also hopefully get those voters to become governor, and I hope can make those changes. Because the changes that are presented by the YPP with the frontman Sunny Ofehe are great ones. They really are. And we have seen it. We went to a town hall meeting, we went to other meetings, and Sunny had amazing ideas which other African leaders have never known before. So, I hope in March this will make a great, great difference, because today, as I was talking with all those bright people here, with creative minds, people who actually dare to think outside their own borders, I hope we can support His Excellency in a way that actual change can be brought to the Delta State. So thank you very much, and I hope we can bring this to a good end. Thank you.
Thank you. We have a Zoom address by her
later.
Okay. Well, then we're just going to move swiftly to the short documentary film by our...
How can I maximize the opportunities that I've seen?
...on the environmental degradation in the oil-rich Niger Delta region of Nigeria.
My name is Comrade Ofehe, an environmental and human rights activist from the Niger Delta. The Niger Delta is an oil-producing region of Nigeria. Despite the huge oil reserve, the people suffer from environmental damages resulting from oil extraction by the oil multinational companies. In 2009, I visited the communities around the two biggest deep-sea offshore oil drilling platforms. Unfortunately, the people living in those communities have no schools, electricity, and the worst situation is that they have no piping water. As you can see from this video, I recorded the whole communities drink from this patched, improvised water well containing bad, unhygienic water.
A great pleasure to invite to the podium our own special man, friend, partner, the next governor of Delta State, His Excellency Comrade Chief Dr. Sonny Ofehe under the PPP logo. God bless you. Come.
Appreciate it. You can stand with me. Ladies and gentlemen, first and foremost, I want to thank you from the depth of my heart for taking time off your very busy schedule to honor our invitation. The reason why I am doing this is because I've spent the better part of my years living in this country than I've ever lived in my country. You just watched the short documentary film. It's a summary of something about me. Let me start like this. I was 23 years old. As a university student, I was very much involved in student unionism. And at the time, we had military government in place in Nigeria. And so there was an election conducted in 1993, and the election was won overwhelmingly by someone that Nigerians decided to choose to take over from military rule. And the military government at the time didn't want to relinquish power to the democratically elected president at the time. So as students, we came under the banner of the National Association of Nigerian Students to protest to ensure that we return our country to democratic rule. And I was very much involved in that demonstration. And there were military clampdown, and most of the student union leaders had to leave the country. And then I also needed to leave the country also. But then the problem of getting the finances to leave the country at that time became very difficult. So, and my mom just divorced my dad, and we're two for my mom, myself, and my younger sister, who currently lives in Denmark. So we left for Benin, and then I remember telling my mom that if we cannot get the money, why don't we sell our house? And without hesitation, she agreed that we should sell the house. And so we sold the house for those who know Nigerian currency, for 500,000 naira at the time. My mom gave me 475,000 to 25,000 so that she can rent another apartment and pay for 6 months up front. And so I left for Kano in the up north. I had not been in the plane before. And so somehow it happened that KLM was the only flight flying out of Kano at the time. And then I boarded KLM flights for the first time in my life, and I came to Schiphol Airport in Amsterdam. I was 23 years old, didn't know anybody in this country, didn't come with a passport, no visa, and with just $5 in my pocket. And my journey started from Schiphol. So we're taken to Zevena, where we're processed for 2 days, and then from there, I was transferred to a small, tiny city called Kampen. And then from there to Zwolle. And then from there, they told me I didn't come with enough evidence to prove my political asylum. I didn't know at that time that the Dutch immigration people wanted me to, if I'm being tortured, I should tell the soldiers torturing me to hold on a beat and sign a paper. Please, I'll be going to Holland in some months. Just give me an evidence that you've tortured me so that when they ask me evidence for the torture, I can produce your letter. And then I was thrown out. And then within this short time, I happened to have a friend who we grew up together in Nigeria. He was living in Rotterdam. And then he called me and said I can come and stay with him. That was how I found myself in Rotterdam. I became illegal for quite some time. A year after, I met this very beautiful woman standing in front of me, standing by my right hand side here, and we were both illegals. We didn't have documents. And then I remember Nigerians telling us that why would two illegals develop a relationship? Why don't you look for a relationship that can give you residence permit? But then, of course, we knew that, you know, whatever the challenges was at the time, it shouldn't hinder us from being who we need to be. And so, because of my experience of having gone through a political asylum process that did not recognize me as a complete political refugee person, so when my wife became pregnant, we had to prepare her to go into an asylum procedure. You know, so, but then of course, today, somewhere along the line, I went back into the same asylum procedure again, but this time, you know, I knew what they wanted, I gathered what they needed, and then eventually, my political asylum status was granted. And then from there, I could come out and really tell the world what my people were suffering. And so I started like working with organizations like Amnesty International. And then of course, when I came to Rotterdam, it gave me an opportunity to see the double standard of the multinational oil company. I grew up in Nigeria at a time where we had Dutch guys renting our homes, driving themselves, going to marketplaces, getting hooked up with our women, married. And those generations are still very much existing in Europe today, where you see Germans married to Nigerians in Port Harcourt, from River State, from Delta State, from Edo State, because of the natural resources that we had. And then I realized also that I suddenly realized that the double standard, as it was playing itself, we also had some very wonderful Dutch people that I met who wanted the best for myself and for my people. So I decided to be a voice, realizing suddenly that leaving the country was not an opportunity for me to get away from the terrible poverty, terrible neglect, terrible environmental devastation that has been meted upon my people. I decided that it was time for me to also see myself as not just only lucky, but also coming here to also speak for them. So that was my motivation. And then I needed to do it on that platform. So I started the organization called Hope for Nigeria campaign. And then while talking to some of the people in the media, I realized that they were very ignorant of what was actually happening on the ground. So I took my campaign a step further by ensuring that any little opportunity that I have, I bring people who are interested to wanting to come to my place, I bring them back home to my place to see for themselves firsthand the true situation. Even those in the business world have had challenges. You know, we're a country with an average of 200 million people. We're a country that is blessed with enormous natural and mineral resources. We're a country that is blessed, like Pat just said, with intellectually sound-minded people. It's a country that God has blessed in all ramifications, blessed more than any other country in this Europe. But unfortunately, leadership has been our problem. And corruption out of that leadership has been our problem. So I started doing diplomacy, trying to get close to people in power, trying to use the opportunities that I've seen here through business contact with some of the people who are even sitting here today to try to change the narrative in some ways. But I found out that for as long as it is not interesting and it doesn't bring direct benefit to the players themselves, they're not interested. So after a while, I continued with my campaign. And then, of course, I was just doing my normal thing as a Nigerian living here, telling the people the true situation back home. And then the system started testing me. And so I brought some members of parliament to Nigeria to show them some of the suffering of our people. One of the MPs who is here tonight was an active MP at that time. So one of his colleagues, Sharon Kestaus, followed me to Nigeria, and I showed her the consequences of gas flare on our lives. And you know, as a kid growing up, gas flare was all over me. And at that time, ignorance, I was thanking the oil companies for providing some source of electricity for us at night because there was no power. Little did I know that the gas flare was actually constituting to some of the health damages that we were facing at that time, that most of us out of ignorance were pointing to the devil, pointing to witchcraft as being the source of those problems. We have premature births, we have stunted growths, we have bronchitis, we had all sorts of cancers, skin, we had all sorts of lung-related diseases that were coming from that. Even our mothers were using the heat from the gas flare to dry our meats, our fishes, and even our yam, plantains, and all of that, because we didn't know the consequence, and the oil companies never educated us on the consequence of those damage. Now, having realized that it is not like that, so I started speaking. So I started bringing people to see what they've done. And then when we came back from that trip, they called for a parliamentary hearing. And then I was invited to speak at the Tweede Kamer, the House Committee on Economic Affairs. And then when I went there, I remember them telling me to send in my what I was going to talk on in paper. So I wrote to them, I sent them an email, I say, you know, our problem cannot be explained in writing. I've lived it. I don't know what I'm going to say tomorrow, but I'm going to speak tomorrow. And then I spoke 11 days after, 35 Dutch police officers raided my house in Rotterdam here. They arrested me for 2 weeks, kept me incommunicado. You know, I remember telling the two officers who picked me up during the interrogation, I told them that Martin Luther King says something, and I quote, "No force in the world can stop an idea whose time has come." I said, as on November 26, when I was leaving Nigeria, it was my flesh that was coming to join my spirit. My spirit was long gone. So there's nothing you can do to me. I'm not a criminal. Search me everywhere, you will never get anything against me. But the naming and shaming that you're trying to do, I will use everything in my capacity to fight it. And truth will always remain truth. However, I lost some friends. I had to rebuild some, and some stood with me. But then I realized that it is It is not time for me to prove who I am. It is time for what I do to speak for me. And thank God I overcame it. And then in 2007, my mom, who made all those sacrifices, I was called up one afternoon, and I was told that some hoodlums came to the house pretending that I sent a message for her. And then she opened for them, fed them, gave them drink, and then afterward, they strangled her to death. So it took me 10 years to give her a befitting funeral. And so in 2017, they told me that if you can bring these kind of people to your mom's funeral, it is time for you to stand up for your people. So I came back. I told myself that, yes, I want to serve my people. God has given me the opportunity to see the difference between how it is done in a society that has value for every citizen and how it is done for a society that don't care about their people. And then I declared that I was going to run as a governorship candidate. So in 2019, I joined the National Ruling Party. I did everything, and Mr. Decker, who is sitting here today, gave me the money to pay for that nomination. I just want you to stand a bit, you and your wife, stand up so that they can recognize your leadership. They gave me the money for the farm in 2019, and I went very optimistic. You know, to run governorship race in my country, it's not easy. The estimated value in terms of money that you need is $300 million. I repeat, $300 million. And the election, the campaign would finish it. I knew that. So in 2019, I told myself that I may not have the money, but what I have, money cannot buy. I'll go into this race because there is a saying that evil triumphs because good people refuse to do something. I'll go into this race wherever it leads me to, even if it brings me disgrace and shame, I will take it. But I need to fight my way. And for those who are Christians here, the Bible said, the kingdom of God suffered violence, and violence taken it by storm. I went and I prayed, and I said, God, you know my heart. I may not have what it takes, but I'm going on this race. 2 days to when I was to pick up my phone, they told me that, they called me up and they said, well, the party chairman at the state level called me up and he said, Sonny, the form costs 23 million naira. And I don't think you want to waste your money. If you buy this form, you will lose because we have decided on who will be giving the ticket to. I couldn't sleep that night. I went to court. I sued the party. I sued everybody that was involved in the process. They told me I was carrying out anti-party activities. Her Royal Majesty, the Queen of the Kingdom of Wari, who is going to be joining us by Zoom. So they just came on somehow. And, you know, so after much pressure, I decided that, okay, well, they said, oh, you're young, you're still young. Yeah, you cannot do anything if you challenge it. And eventually I had to step down, work with the party, but somehow the party lost the elections. So coming to 2023, I decided that I was not going to run under any of these two big political parties. I wouldn't want my destiny to be decided by a few people who would just wake up one day and tell me when to sleep and when to wake up. So I ended it there, and then on top of that, the two big political parties, gradually, their popularity started fading. and they were not popular because of the current economic situation in Nigeria. We've been at a very low level. The naira to the dollar has completely crashed, and of course the unemployment rate is increasing on a daily basis. Hunger, poverty has become endemic, and so I decided that I was going to run my governorship candidacy under a very different political party. And then eventually I settled for the Young Progressive Party, went into the primaries, won the primaries, and I became the candidate for the general election. So 2023, history is already made. I'll be the first Nigerian living in Europe to run and contest for the position of governorship in the state's election. And what is interesting here is that I'm not just running as a governorship candidate in any other state in Nigeria. I'm running as a governorship candidate in one of the richest states in sub-Saharan Africa. Delta is currently Nigeria's largest producer of crude oil. Delta is currently the state in Nigeria that has the highest gas reserve in the country. Delta is the only state in Nigeria that has 4 under-functioning seaports. Delta is the only state in Nigeria that has the longest coastline, 162 square kilometers of coastline that we're not utilizing at all. Delta is the only state that has the biggest gas plant in the whole of Africa. Delta is the only state in Nigeria that has the highest number of tertiary institutions in the country. Therefore, Delta is the state that has the most intellectually sound young people in the country. And beside that, Delta is one of the states that receives beyond the federal allocation that comes from the top in Abuja. Delta is the one of the very few 9 states in Nigeria that gets 13% derivation from profits made from sales of crude oil. And in that 13%, Delta states in 2022 received a whopping 142 billion in our local currency in revenue. Delta state is the only state, no, it's among the 4 states that get another 2% of profit made by the oil companies into the state. So what that means is that if Delta state has good leadership, our GDP at the end of every year will make us the 7th largest economy in sub-Saharan Africa. As it stands right now, if things are done the way it should be done, Delta State is richer than even Ghana as a country. This is the state I am running as a governorship candidate. And now, over the years, having spent 27 years in this place, I know some of you pride yourself as having done the most successful business with people coming from Nigeria. But I will shock you tonight that whatever you have made from Nigeria is a tip in the iceberg compared to what you will make. If Delta State, and indeed Nigeria as a country, has a leadership that understands the challenges that you face and is ready to use the power at the executive level to correct most of those challenges. And to be very frank with you, it is that bureaucracy, that bottleneck in doing business, in ensuring that the ease of doing business with my country is bettered in a way that we can increase output. That is the thing that is actually motivating me to run this race. Some of us do businesses and we have 2 challenges even from the very beginning. The first is when your customer even buy your thing, how do your customer even remit money to pay completely? It's not as if the customer does not have the money in his account. He has a naira. But how do you translate that naira into euro currency that will make it easy for him to pay very quickly. That's one problem. And some customers want to see what they buy. And so they have the money, they have everything, they apply for visa, they are refused. And so some of these challenges have actually killed businesses. And so most of the people who are supposed to be doing business with Europeans are now moving to Singapore, Malaysia, and even China. Even when they know that what they get from those countries are in no way compared in quality to what you can offer them from Europe. All of these can be corrected with the right leadership. And in order to deal with that, I've told my people back in Delta that I will be the first governor of the states that will set up a business hub here in Rotterdam to deal with some of those challenges that you currently face, so that we can increase the foreign direct investment possibilities that we want to bring to the state, and ensure that when you have customers who are struggling to pay you here, our hub can act as a payment point for some of those monies that you want. And our hub can also ensure that we do due diligence on customers who can and have the capacity to come and inspect what they want to buy and go back, instead of the embassy just looking at them from afar and not knowing who to give visa to and who not to give visa to, and then therefore denying the right people from getting that visa opportunity. These are some of the things that we want to do. Now, as a YPP governorship candidate in my state, what are my chances? The money is not there, of course. And I've been rolling and powering under the support of some very few people, and some of them are even in this house, who have gone way beyond what they can even do, believing in me and ensuring that they provide what I need to be able to steer this campaign to where we currently are today. Some of you who've been to Nigeria with me, you will agree with me that I am enjoying overwhelming support from the ordinary people. If I'm able to sustain this momentum that I have now, I can guarantee you that after March 11, before the official swearing in on the 29th of May, 2023, I will invite you here again. In this time, I'll be speaking in the capacity of the incoming governor of one of the largest economies in sub-Saharan Africa. It is not by mistake that Bart is referring to me as His Excellency. People are already seeing me in that capacity. And on the ballot, we have 16 political parties in Nigeria. 14 political parties have fielded candidates. And among those candidates, of course, we only have two big political parties, the APC and the PDP. One is at the national level, and one is dominating at the state level. And the candidate for the PDP is currently the Speaker of the State House of Assembly. And the candidate of the APC is currently the Deputy Senate President of the country. In the hierarchy of presidency, if the President, the Vice President, and the Senate President, and the Speaker of the House of Assembly fly in one plane and something happens, the DSP becomes the President of Nigeria. That tells you the powers that I'm fighting against. And then they roll in their convoy with our stolen commonwealths to now come back again to the same people, asking them to vote for them. Every day, one of the things that I spend the most money on is my security, my vehicle movement, and the logistics for even accommodation. And these people get it for free because they're already in government, and they even get allowances for the campaigns that they do, a privilege that I do not enjoy. But I knew all of this before I embarked on this race. And in doing this, I knew I was going to face the odds. Everybody has told me, my ears are full, telling me 1,001 reasons why they strongly believe that I cannot make it. And the only reason they give is because I don't have the money. And of course they're correct, I do not have the money. And in understanding all of these, in the summer of last year, I traveled to Lisbon. Why did I go to Lisbon? When I was in the primary school and secondary school, I used to represent my school in a quiz competition. And so through that quiz competition, I became exposed early to things that are happening in the world. I went to Lisbon because I wanted to follow the steps of Vasco da Gama. I think I'm getting a call from. Hello?
Hello?
Yeah, you ready? Okay, good. Yeah, okay. So let's hear Her Royal Majesty, the Queen of the Great Kingdom of Wari, that is in Delta States. Let us hear her address us here.
Hey, hello, good evening, how are you?
Very well, thank you. Good to have you with us. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you perfectly.
Okay, good to have you with us. Her Royal Majesty, I was just telling my audience that it's a great privilege to have you with us. You're looking gorgeous as usual, so I'm very proud of that. I have here seated great men and women from the business community within Europe, and we are doing this as a sort of rehearsal for the eventual visit of yourself and His Royal Majesty, the King of the Kingdom of Wari. And so some of the people here today are familiar with our kingdom. Some of them have done businesses there before. So I just want to leave the floor for you to introduce yourself, tell us a bit about the kingdom, and then tell us a bit about His Royal Majesty's roadmap as we discussed in Abuja. And then most importantly, tell us about your passion for education, women, children, and the possibility of getting them access to scholarship, which of course I know you have a strong passion for. And then conclude by also telling us what to expect and what do you need from us when the monarch eventually visits us in the end of April. Thank you, you have the floor now.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Sunny Ofehe. Thank you so much for that debrief. Good evening, everyone. My name is Olori Atuashe III. I'm the Queen Consort of the Wari Kingdom. My husband is the 21st Olu of Wari, which is a sitting one of the first-class monarchs in our great nation, Nigeria. And he presides over about 250 communities in across Delta and Edo State, which is the south-south region of Nigeria, just to make it a bit understandable for everyone. A bit about his economic roadmap. When he's been sitting on the throne now, he ascended the throne on the 21st of August, 2021, and they call him the progressive king, the progressive monarch. His majesty, in his short time, has a desire to really bring economic development to our region. And not just the kingdom that he's sitting on and presides over, but actually across the entire Delta State. We have a slogan where we say Wari to the world. We're looking to open up our kingdom and the state to foreign direct investment for development across the private property, real estate development, to oil and gas, to shipping, all the way through to technology. We're really looking to bring the kingdom into the 21st century and see how we, not even see how, our dream is really to make the monarchy relevant and taking off a little bit off the edge of the public service and actually seeing how we can partner, use our position as leverage to partner with the international community to actually bring investment and development into our nation. The Wari Kingdom is one of the top oil producing kingdoms or people in Nigeria. I think we're currently ranked around, if not the highest. The oil reserves in our kingdom are probably the most lucrative. But as we know, unfortunately, it doesn't always correlate to the state of the people. We are one of the poorest in Nigeria at the moment, and so we're looking to see how we could change the narrative and even diversify from oil. We know that the world is moving towards clean energy, and seeing how we can really begin to use the environment and clean energy to better our state, to better our people, and to better ourselves. That is really it from me. With regards to, I think Mr. Sunny Ofehe said I should speak about my love for education. Honestly, it's beyond a love. I believe it's a calling. One of the reasons I think Nigeria is where it's at, and even I would make bold to say as far as Africa is where it's at, is because of a lack of capacity development in the people. And so we have a huge number. I know that Africa is one of the most populous nations, most populous continents in the world. However, our human capital is grossly underdeveloped. The quality of our education compared to global standards is dismal, to say the least. And so it's my dream and my desire, really. I think it's the people that change the nation. As much as we bring development and as much as we bring, you know, agriculture and all those things to a people, if they're underdeveloped, then it will just fall through, really. And so it's my dream to really bring transformation to the nation through education. I know I kind of rhymed a little bit, but that's really my dream, to see quality education implemented in Nigeria, starting from my small kingdom in the south of Nigeria, but also stretching across the nation. I have a particular interest, maybe because I'm a woman, for women and the girl child, and children in general, but particularly the girl child. We know that in Africa, there is a huge gender bias towards women. And interestingly, in the role, in the position I play, you know, as queen, we are not to be seen or heard. And so I'm a bit of a rebel, even the fact that you can see or hear me as you're speaking to me, because that's just the patriarchy, the traditions have kept women under for so long, and it's my desire to really see, and we know that, even using the West, that women are the backbone of society. You know, there's a saying that you give a woman of money and somehow it just trickles down the community a lot more than if men are equipped. And so I see, it's my dream to see women educated, skilled, and empowered to be the best that they can be. And that will also stretch across the girl child. What are we expecting when we come to the Netherlands? There is so much on the table, from agriculture to, you know, when I mean agriculture, I'm talking, my husband's very interested in, because we're a water-based region, or we're across the coastline, my husband is interested in developing our fishing industry. I know that the Netherlands are very much, they're very skilled in that, and so we're looking for partners with regards to that. We're also looking for partners with regards to looking for how we can secure our shoreline. There's been a lot of erosion in our communities because of just a lack of shoreline protection. And so we're looking for partners that would come and do that, to bring development by way of clean energy. Like I said, the environment, because we're an oil producing kingdom, there's a lot of gas flaring, a lot of oil spillage in our environment, and we want to really begin to open those discussions to see how we can further help our environment, help our people, and also bring clean energy to the space. There's so much that we have in store. And we're hoping that our trip in April will really begin to start communications and, you know, bridge and offer networking solution and networking opportunities so that we can have relationships that really begin to bridge the gap that we have between prosperity and production. So thank you very much, and we look forward to meeting you or seeing you all in April. Thank you. Over to you, Mr. Sunny.
Her Majesty, I want to thank you for taking time off your very busy schedule. I understand from your... I understand from your assistant that you just did a domestic flight. And even at that, when I got the other call, I was hearing siren in the background. So... we're really indeed very honored and privileged to have you still squeeze the time to address this house. One thing I want to assure you from this end is that you've just spoken to a conglomeration of diversity in all of the sectors that you have mentioned. I think we have at least one or two, three persons who are very grasped in those areas. So what we're actually doing here is to see how we can arrange beside all of other activities that we will be lining up for your visit, also organize a business forum where we will bring people from diverse fields to have a discussion with yourself and His Royal Majesty. Like I've always told them, I am so proud to have a monarchy as yours, young, intellectually sound, knowledgeable, exposed. So that was where actually the synergy came from when I had the opportunity to meet you and His Royal Majesty in Abuja. And then of course I missed you in the last palace visit just last week, you know. But I didn't miss you so much because I know we'll be having your attention when you eventually come to the Netherlands. So on behalf of my team here and all of the people who are here, I want to say a very big thank you. But I will not let this conversation be dominated by black people alone. So I will want one white guy to volunteer himself to also address you here so that we can balance color here, you know, before you leave us. So I don't know who is ready to speak. Yeah, you were also in that meeting.
We meet each other in Nigeria. The last time I was standing in front of you, I was all wearing sneakers and some t-shirts because I was coming from a terrible delayed flight. So I'm a little bit dressed up better now. And I think it's an honor for us European people, especially here in the Netherlands, to have you here. I think it's unique. It's also something that maybe never will happen again, maybe. But we're really looking forward to work together. And as we also spoke about in your house in Abuja, there's a lot to do for children, especially also in the field of healthcare. And everybody is having his own reasons to be here and to have his own business. But I hope the focus on children, I think, is the most important part, because that's the future of us, that's the future of your country. And for me, it's the reason that I will be here. Again, thank you, and we will meet again in April. Bye-bye, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
Okay, at this juncture, we want to leave you to continue, because I know there's a lot happening behind the scene there. Once again, on behalf of everybody here, I want to say a very big thank you. And then when you come, we will have the opportunity to engage all of these people that are here today. But be rest assured that the problems and challenges that we carry as a kingdom, as a state, and as a country, I am very much involved in it. So I will lay the ground ready for your coming, and hopefully we can be able to provide those solutions that will be sustainable over time. So before you leave, I want all of us to just stand up and give you a very big kingdom and greet His Royal Majesty for us. Hopefully we'll see you in April. Thank you and God bless you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you so much. We look forward to seeing you in April as well.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye now.
Bye-bye. Okay. In any case, well, I am on this ballot. It's been, you just heard Her Royal Majesty right now. As a monarchy, they are not expected to officially declare their support for any political candidates. But I can assure you that they see me as the best candidate in this general election, and that is a very big boost for my candidacy. Now, I will win this election.
Woo! Amen.
I need your support. Yes. The consultation so far, the responses so far, and the way, for those of you who have been part of my campaign, you will agree with me that the people really want to change. And they see me as that change. And I know I can make the change. I need your support. Right now is, I don't have any godfather. I don't have, one of the things that kills our democratic process and kill people when they, and stop them from doing the right thing when they get to power is that they have sponsors. They have cabals who put them there and they do their bidding instead of doing the bidding of the ordinary people. I do not have that. I have sustained so far with the little support that I get from people who tell me that, well, we believe in you, we know you can make a change. This is all we can do. Most of us here are business people. Please, take this risk for me. Be part of this beginning that people don't see. So that tomorrow, when I eventually become the governor of my state, you saw those poor kids. I was one time like them. I cannot live in peace here when I see that friends that I grew up with, you've met some of them, grew up with 30 something years ago, still ask me today, married with children, still ask me today to leave my singlet, my boxer for them. It's a shame. This is where my country is. This is where my state is. And I have the capacity to take a lot of people out of poverty. Because I've seen that your own development here is not rocket science. 96, when I came, I knew how many lanes were in Schiphol, the highway leading from Rotterdam to Schiphol. But I know how many you have now. I've seen transformation in my time here. It's not rocket science, it's dedication, patriotism, and your ability to tell yourself that I'm going to leave a legacy behind. Everything my corrupt politicians steal for, God has given me the privilege to enjoy them without money. Is it flying in a plane? Is it staying in a hotel? Is it traveling around the world? I've enjoyed it. I cannot steal for those things anymore. And this is what my leaders are stealing for. They are clueless, they have nothing new to offer, but we have something to offer. If I don't win this election, it is not because I didn't want to win it. It is because most of you still felt that my candidacy is not worth taking the risk for. Please, I have no other person to call my own. After 27 years in this country, after the networking that I've done with some of you, it is a shame that I still have just 6 persons who have made financial contributions to my campaign. Sometimes I ask myself, was it really a relationship I was building with some of these Dutch people? So please, some of the contributions you can even make are tax deductible. get it back, because they're going to be donations. I am going back again on the 10th. Presidential election is on the 25th of February. And between then and March 11, a lot will happen. To tell you how ambitious I was, I did this in 2019. So when some group of people decided to derail my destiny, I kept it and I said my destiny must still hold. But the content of it still live with us till this time. So you're going to be having it, and in it you're going to have something like this. Please keep it to yourself. You know, when I become the president, I've always said, and some of you have even predicted it, when I become the governor of Delta State, because of what I will do for my people and my states, I'll be a short away from becoming the president of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. And if you still have this one with you at that time, you can be rest assured that when I become 80, and you put this on auction, all your investments will return back to you. Because you'll be selling something that you took at a time when most people doubted that this journey was not going to lead to this. Please, you will get your own, don't worry. And then there is an appeal later inside. Please, whatever you can do. Talk to your neighbor. You can get something to eat, and then we'll continue. Thank you. God bless you. Bye bye.
Well done.
Yeah,
one run.
Ofehe is running he's running for governor in the Delta State.
Yes.
And you are his wife. Your name is Dorothy Ofehe.
Yes.
So are you proud of him?
Very, very proud of him. I'm proud of him. Yes.
I see you laughing, so yes. I think, yeah, I get a big smile. So we believe you are proud of him.
Very proud.
And why is that?
I'm proud of him because I believe in him. I know he can do it. He's the best candidate for the 2023 election.
To go a little bit deeper, what do you think he is? Is that important that Sonny Ofehe is running for governor right now in the Delta State, especially the Delta State?
Yeah, because the people there are really suffering and they really need the best person to take over the Delta State.
What is the capacity of Mr. Sonny Ofehe that you think he can run for governor, or he will become the governor of the Delta State?
He will be the governor of Delta State. He's capable.
Do you think that he has certain kind of skills because he was living in, or he's living in, like in Europe for many years?
Yes, because he has lived here for a long time with the white people, so he knows the right thing to do.
You just said he is living here a long time.
Long time, for 27 years in the Netherlands.
So he is also diaspora.
Yeah, he's a diaspora.
To bring skills and knowledge what is not there in the African continent.
Yes, exactly.
So we can evolve and so we can develop a lot.
Yeah, he's
a people's person.
He's man of the people. I know he can do it.
Thank you very much for
Thank
this
you.
Moment.
Thank you. God bless you. Thank
So, Sonny Ofehe, welcome in Rotterdam, third place. You are now in third place. You have an amazing event here. What was your main reason to be here?
Well, the reason I came here is for, you know, I've lived in the Netherlands for 27 years, and over those long time, I've built relationship with people. I've done businesses with people. I've actually engaged with a lot of people from, you know, government angle, institution angle, civil society angle. And so as a politician now, that is on the ballot for the next governorship elections in Delta State, I feel I owe them a duty to update them as to my progress, why I am running, and what I think, what the potential that abound in my state is, and how we can marry that with the opportunities that are available in Europe. So I tagged today's event as Delta Meets the World, meaning Delta has a lot to offer because we're a very rich state. We have abundant natural and mineral resources. And on top of that, we have human capacity as well. You know,
we will come about.
Yes, and we are strategically also located in Nigeria. Oil and gas and all of those things that defines the Dutch economy is what we have, but unfortunately we do not have the right leadership that can be able to harness those opportunities in a way that people can benefit locally from it. So, and this is the motivation behind my running as a governorship candidate. And so I want to also be prepared, because in the course of my campaign, I've told them that foreign direct investment is my core area of specialty, and I believe strongly that any economy that needs to evolve over time in Nigeria currently has to depend on foreign direct investment. And I am the only one on that ballot that has this international clout to be able to bring people on the basis of relationship, trust, and credibility. Because as you know, Nigeria is considered an unsafe place. If you check Western Embassy's website and you say you want to visit, it's always red alert in majority of the cities. So no investor is willing to go to such place and do investment. So coming to them now is to tell them that no, you know, now you have your own that has been with you, running for the election, and if I win this election, I understand what your concerns are in order to ensure that there is a win-win situation for all parties. This is the reason why we gathered here this evening.
Thank you. There are also a lot of white people, your friend, and some are contributing to your campaign already. Also, some of them went to Nigeria with you. What is the image now about, or the imagination about, or the prospect about Nigeria now?
Well, we had a few of them talk, like Dr. Ernst, the 19-year-old boy who recently went with us. He also spoke, and Diederik also spoke. And in the house, I had like five or six persons that have been to Nigeria with me. So their perception about Nigeria have changed generally. And the reason why I try as much as possible to ensure that there is a European at least on my trip to Nigeria is for them to come back and let the world know that we are not as the country is not as insecure as the Western country tends to portray, and that the people are not as bad as the Western countries try to portray. That we are peace-loving people, we are kind, we show humane spirits when we receive visitors, we show them love, even when we are hungry. We still find a way to show smile and to be accept people who come to us. And this is what they see when they get there. And of course, they also see that the people are poor because of leadership. They also see the overwhelming, resources and the God-given nature that we have. And so having them experience that and come back and talk to people here helps my case in wanting to let them believe that as a governor for Delta State, their investment will be safe in my hands, and I will guarantee return on such investment should they come and join me. And so that is the take home from today's meeting. I think that we've been able to put that across, and then to have Her Royal Majesty the Queen also speak to them. Look at how intellectually sound she was, And these are supposed to be the face of Nigeria to the world. But unfortunately, we have leadership that are clueless, cannot even express themselves, do not even know what they want, let alone finding solution to their people. So this is the narrative we're trying to change, so that we can have young people who are exposed, who are intelligent, who have the capacity to be able to represent us, not just at the state level, not just at the national level, but on the global level.
Thank you. Yeah. That is all the answers it's a mouthful. You are speaking about human capacity, you are talking about human capital, but there are also challenges. What are the challenges that you are facing now? Because you are diaspora, I can call you diaspora because you live for many years here in Holland, Rotterdam. So what are the challenges that you are facing up running for governor in Delta State?
Well, ironically, as a diaspora Nigerian, it's not really affected me so much because I have done a lot, even as a diaspora. All of my activism are centered community-based, and that brings me to Nigeria all the time. That gives me, I gather the information that I need to show to the world. So nobody has even dared to see my diaspora nature as a hindrance to my political campaign. The only thing I face right now is that due to corruption and having people in government who have systematically stolen our commonwealth, refined those commonwealth and used them to come back to us to want to ask for public office, these are the people that I am contending with. Like I said during my speech, my two big political opponents, one of them is the Speaker of the State House of Assembly, who is still using the instrument of states to campaign. And then the second one is the Deputy Senate President at the national level, who is still using the instrument of the states to campaign against me. So even their convoy, security, movement around, allowances are paid by the state, taxpayers' money. But then I have to also look for how to pay for myself. So these are the challenge. So financial funding the campaign is the only challenge. And that is why I'm calling on everyone who believe in this cause to support this cause, because this is the closest you can ever get close to having your own as the governor of a rich state in Nigeria. The people are tired. of the status quo, things are difficult for them. Unemployment rate is so high, the Naira has devalued. The essential needs of every human being is almost non-existent. People don't have jobs, people cannot even, there's no middle class. In my country, there's no middle class, and you cannot build an economy when there is a vacuum in the middle class. And so, so these are the challenge. And so, but I've been able to maximize the little opportunity that I have financially in a way that the result that is coming in clearly shows that God is behind this, my mandate. And if I can sustain this momentum right now, I am very sure that getting to March 11, we'll be able to get more people who will support my candidacy, and also will be willing to vote for me on that day. I've told them that, you know, any vote I get on March 11 will not be votes that I paid money to get like my other political opponent. There will be votes that actually came from people who strongly believe that I can be their governor. And those are the people I'm standing for in these coming elections.
So I'm really proud of you.
Thank you so much.
And do you have a last thing to say to your own people? But before we leave, do you have ever other diaspora run for governor?
Well, as far as my history or knowledge is concerned, no. From Europe, no. Because you see, the thing is that it is very daunting. I mean, the amount of money required is so huge. And the people that will always tell you you cannot make it are enormous. If I would want to follow that, I would not be standing here running this today, because I would have been completely discouraged.
But why are you doing it?
I am doing,
taking a stand,
yes,
right?
I am
now
doing, because I am one person who the best of me comes out when I am underestimated. You know, the more the voices are telling me I cannot do it, the more I am finding an internal depth in myself to prove them wrong. So now I am not looking at men, I'm looking at God. And I'm telling God, you know, for once in the democratic process in Nigeria, shock everybody. I have the capacity, you have made me, you've taken me through journey, up and down, rough and tough. Give me this mandate. And in this mandate, people will even turn to you and say, God, where was this one?
I have a last question. What is the first thing that you will do when you are governor in the Delta State?
The first thing I will do when I am governor of Delta State is to stand up and let the whole world know that for the first time in Nigerian democratic history, the voices of the people have been heard. There is a Latin word that says, vos populi, vos Dei, meaning the voice of the people are the voice of God, because it will be clear to everyone, it will be clear to everyone that this was not a mandate delivered by man. It was a mandate delivered by the Almighty God.
So it is not the voice of the people?
Godfathers, no.
But it's the voice?
No, you know, it's the voice of the people and not the voice of the Godfather. And because the voice of the people is the voice of God, and that is why I am here. And so I will be owing it to the people to give back to them all that I promised in the course of my campaign. And I know I can deliver that. Thank you
Thank
for having
you.
Me. Thank you.
You will deliver.
Thank you. Thank you.